Hi, my name's Dave Kelly. I'm going to talk about COVID-19 and how I caught it and about how I coped with it and hopefully beat it. So you could say COVID-19, me 20, how I beat COVID and survived to tell the tale. So as we know, 2020 was an absolute year of pain, year of worry, fear. It was a year of COVID-19. And it all started officially on the 23rd of March, 2020. We hadn't really heard much of this this virus that was swamping the world, and there's all talk of these every other year. There's bird flu, there's whatever, chicken flu, and it never really reaches us. SARS, MERS, you know, it's scaremongering. That's what we thought, and I didn't feel any difference. I knew there's something coming our way, maybe, but it'll be okay. And it started to, on the news, sound a bit worse, a little bit like it is coming, it's heading our way. And on the 21st of March, that's my birthday, that was a Friday. And I ended up having me cake in Daisy with the work, and we had a fish and chip meal. And all of us together, and it was good. No, happy birthday. We're still a bit of a worry over COVID-19, but we're okay. Next day, I went to town in North Wales, went to a caravan with my wife and my daughter, and just to spend a nice time in Wales, relaxing. And I felt awful, really. I felt a bit ill, actually. A bit of a cold coming on, and that was the beginning. Yeah, on my birthday, I must have caught this bug. Didn't quite know what it was at the time. And while I was in Wales on that day, and I was really ill, I got a phone call. I was off one of our trustees, at Daisy, and she told me, with real sad voice, as you can imagine, that her dad had passed away of COVID-19, coronavirus. And I was like shocked and horrified, thinking, what? Is it his own? This is real. This is, you know, people who we know passing away with this horrendous COVID-19. So we had to get out of the caravan anyway, because Wales was locking down and everything. So off we went, and I was feeling rotten, temperature, you know, so tired, coughing. And this is, strange things happen. I couldn't eat because I couldn't taste nothing, I couldn't smell anything. I remember, I'm blind, so my touch and taste and smells is heightened, and I'd lost that. And I thought, this is strange. This is before we knew, you know, the symptoms of COVID-19. This is right at the beginning, really. So I was in a house, couldn't go to work, couldn't go to Daisy, which anyone who knows me, there must have been something really bad with me, because I never miss out on Daisy because I love it. But couldn't go. I felt so ill, tired. And I was in bed, my bedroom, just with the radio on, listening to how many people were infected, how many people were passing away, dying from it. Hospitals getting full, save the NHS. It was just horrendous. And I was like getting worse and worse. By this time, my wife was coughing She had this horrible cough. She wasn't too well. She probably had it as well. Now, it was that feeling of feeling so tired, so ill, and it was just getting worse and worse. And it was really a little bit scary, to be honest with you, because, you know, I've had flus before, I've had all that, but this was something different. This was like, you know, mega. It was taking over my body, my mind. I was just so lopsidical, sleeping all the time. And for about 2 weeks or so, I was getting worse and worse. And another third week passed, getting no better with it. In fact, there was a moment for a week in between everything, I was at my worst. And that was what's horrible. Boris Johnson had just gone into hospital himself. And was he going to get a ventilator? Was he going to die? Was he going to pass away? And at the same time, I'm listening to this on the radio. I was like sloping off into like some kind of oblivion state. I was so damn ill. Couldn't concentrate. I wanted to be with my daughter. I wanted it, but I had to keep her out of the bedroom. Didn't hold her or hug her for 5 weeks. And just the absolute thought of falling asleep, because I knew if I fell asleep, I'm not going to wake up. My chest, like someone standing on it. Couldn't get any air in, couldn't get any air out. It was like the most horrible thing ever. I said to the wife, I said, listen, whatever happens, don't phone an ambulance for me. If I'm going to go, I'm going to go in my own house. I want to go peacefully here. Please don't phone an ambulance, promise me. She promised me she wouldn't. And I was really at a stage where she was crying and upset, and she's worried. I said, don't tell my daughter, Shana, don't tell any family or friends how bad I am. Don't want anyone to worry. Just let me go through it. And because I didn't want to sleep, I said, I was playing the radio, I was listening to anything to keep me awake, because I knew if I closed my eyes and fell asleep, I wouldn't wake up. Fighting that all the time. And during the worst night, standing at the side of my bed was my dad and my brother, which is lovely. Half of them, they passed away years earlier, so they were there. I was just bizarre speaking to them, telling me not to worry, not your time, telling me to, you know, you'll be okay. And I'm saying, what I'll do is not this. And I was just chatting away. And I felt good. And I remember, because I'm blind and that, but I could actually visualise them there, over there. And I was like, I felt a bit bizarre. That they couldn't tell anyone there, even. This is the first time I've really told people about this. See me dad and my brother, reassuring me. And I was so determined to fight it, to beat it, and I was doing the EFT, emotional freedom technique, tapping best I could. I was so weak, I couldn't do four rounds. Emotional freedom technique is where you tap certain parts of your body to, you know, to make things better, to unconscious parts of the brain to sort things out for you. And I'm saying, I want to survive. I've got so much to do. I want to see my daughters. I want to, you know, do all the things that I've planned. 2020 was going to be my year, 2020 vision. From way back, I planned so much, you know, for this year that everything was put on hold, unfortunately. So there I was, literally death's door. I've never being in such a position where I was accepting death. I thought, I can't go on, I just feel so ill. And I was like, in my brain, I'm thinking, you know what? Beat it. I can beat this. I can get through it. Just don't fall asleep, whatever you do. And that was on my mind. Constant bombardment of the radio. How many more deaths in, you know, each day? Covid-19, it's just taking over the world. Everyone's panicked, the fear factor. And it was just an awful, awful time. Easter come, Easter. And I could hear people outside, my daughter was in the garden, Easter egg. Trying to find that Easter eggs, where Easter egg comes, waiting for done. I had no strength, I couldn't do it. I could just listen and then I faded away again. And I think one of the worst moments was when Dwight had gone out, so I was on my own, and I was just delirious, and I knew I had to get out of bed, but I didn't know who I was, where I was, where I was going. I just remember I crawled out of bed, I thought, toilet, which way was the toilet? And in my head I'm thinking, must know where the toilet is. Do it for the past, you know, 30 years in this house. And I was lost. I didn't know where I was. I had no sense of direction. I had no memory. It's like my whole memory, short-term memory, being just wiped out. It was just so, that was a scary bit. I'm thinking, you know, where am I? Who am I? Oh. But eventually, you know, after trying, feeling round every room, I found a toilet and made my way back to the bedroom and just slouched on the bed and combed out till the wife had come home. And this was going on for, it was a full week of that utter near-death experience. And then I kind of hit the bottom and started to bounce back a little bit, where I was getting more fluids down me. There was no taste, no smell, but I was eating food knowing I've got to eat, because otherwise, you know, I'll probably die. So I forced it down me. And my brother, you know, he was talking to the wife, and she said, he's not well, David's not well. So they brought round it, was an inhaler, I think it's just an inhaler. And it's one of them, you know, your mental stuff in, boiling water in you, just breathe it in. And you know what? I reckon that saved my life, because when not able to get a bit of breath, coughing and spluttering all the time, you know, sinew in my body was aching due to, you know, that horrible cough, bringing stuff up. And I tried the inhaler and I breathed my first breath, just a little breath, and I felt it going in into the lungs. And the pain, just to do that, was absolutely agonising. But I got that little breath, and then a little bit more. And for a couple of days, I was just taking that little breath, and then a bit more. Eventually, I was able to take a full, beat the pain, and from that, I started to improve, started to, you know, as I said, eat, drink a bit more, get a little bit extra gasping to my lungs, didn't feel good at all, didn't think I was ever gonna get through this, because I never felt so ill. It was the nearest to death I've ever been. And I'll visit that place one more time, and I will be just before the day go, actually. But my belief was, I didn't want to go, I didn't want to die, I didn't want to lose, you know, all the rest of the years with my daughters and family and wife and all the things I've got to do with Daisy and my own personal things I needed to do, like, you know, Dave Kelly, motivational speaker. I love doing that. I wanted to stay alive to do it, and I did. And I got better and better. Each day I was able to walk a little bit. Just the first time to walk down the stairs was horrendous. I was like a 90-year-old. And then I was in the garden. If you remember last year in April, the sun was shining and that. So the sun was out. I was just sitting there like an old man, just getting the sun rays. And I was so tired, falling asleep in the garden, but I'd done it. And bit by bit, day by day, I got better and better and better. And, you know, here we are 12 months on, and I'm perfectly fine. I've still got like trouble with the old lungs, not 100%, still a bit tired, but I fight it. And I beat it every day, beat it every day. So I want to give people to think and a little bit of knowledge of what COVID-19 is. It really does exist, and when it hits you, it can really be devastating. Some people never come through, they lost the battle. Some people, it didn't really affect them, but for me, it's I fought the battle and I beat COVID-19. You could say COVID-19, me 20, the time I beat COVID-19.